Chapter 8, The Trap. As soon as the meeting was over, Sweagle slipped out of the hub and raced down dark streets towards Terrell's office. Mullen and Hughes had said the job would be done very soon, but didn't name a date. So at that moment, Sweagle's was the only one standing between the Coney men and Lincoln's body. Was he really worried about protecting Lincoln's remains? Or was he thinking he lucked into a roper's dream, a nugget of gold that would vastly increase his value in the eyes of the Secret Service? We can't be sure. Sweagle's leaped up the stairs to Terrell's office. The agent was out of town on another investigation. The roper couldn't keep this explosive secret to himself. He found his friend, Charles Dean, and described the Hub gang's bizarre plot. Dean's advice: sit tight, say nothing, wait for Terrell. But Dean couldn't keep the secret either. He told Leonard Sweat, a fellow Chicago lawyer who'd been one of Abraham Lincoln's closest friends. Alarmed, Sweat telegraphed a warning to members of the Lincoln Monument Association in Springfield. Sweat explained that he wasn't sure how serious the threat really was, but added, "Perhaps the slightest intimation of danger ought to induce proper safeguards, if the body is in a position where it could possibly be exposed to such a scheme." The body was most definitely exposed, the Monument Association members knew. They ordered Power to add a night watchman or two at the monument and keep them there until the attempt is made, or danger averted. Power did as he was told. After that, he later wrote, two men, armed each with a revolver, were kept there every night. The custodian patrolled the grounds too, making sure to arrange signals with the guards so the men could recognize each other in the dark cemetery. I was there at nearly all times of night myself to see that the watchmen were on duty, Power said. I had to be very careful about signals to avoid being shot on my own orders. On October 26th, 2 nights after Sweagle's first learned of the plot, Terrell was back in his Chicago office. He was sitting at his desk, working late into the night on his daily report to James Brooks, the new chief of the Secret Service. The door opened and Sweagle's charged in. Something's brewing down at the hub, he announced. Terrell looked up from his papers. Not a Connie job, the roper said. Something much bigger. Terrell listened to a few details, then cut in. He accused Sweagle's of being drunk. Sweagle's denied it. He provided convincing details, like the fact that Hughes and Mullen had researched the law on grave robbing in Illinois and were pleased to find the crime was punishable by only 1 year in county jail. Terrell was stunned. He needed time to think. He told Sweagle's to play along with Hughes and Mullen and to keep in close touch. After Sweagle's left, Terrell picked up his pen and continued his report. Now, Chief, he began, last but not least comes a matter reported to me this evening by Louis Sweagle's. Terrell laid out the incredible story. Sweagle's also says they have some jimmies and one crowbar as tools for the job of breaking into the monument. They feel confident of success, saying that if they do get caught, 'tis only 1 year in jail, and if they succeed, Ben will be liberated. Deeming the matter of national importance, if they commit such a damnable act without detection, I thought best to telegraph the facts as I did this evening to you. Terrell sent his telegraph to Washington. Then he tried to get some sleep. In the morning, he'd have to go see Abraham Lincoln's son. At the age of 33, Robert Lincoln had already lived through several lifetimes worth of drama. Robert was a college student when the Civil War broke out, and he wanted to leave school and enlist in the Union Army. His father, the president, approved. His mother did not. The Lincolns had already watched two young sons die of disease, and Mary could not bear the thought of losing their eldest boy. So Robert stayed at Harvard after he graduated in 1864 and entered law school. But his absence from the army was becoming a national scandal. Newspapers called Robert a daft dodger and a coward. They accused the president of hiding his son in school while sending other men's boys out to fight and die. Mary finally relented, allowing Robert to join the army in early 1865. When the fighting ended in April, he returned to Washington, D.C. On the night of April 14th, he was spending a quiet evening in his White House bedroom when he heard people shouting that his father had just been shot at Ford's Theater. Jumping into a carriage, he raced to the scene and was told the president had been taken to a house across the street. He tried to enter, but soldiers blocked the door. "It's my father!" Robert shouted. "My father!" Robert stumbled inside, stepping over pools of blood on the floor. Already weeping, he ran to his dying father. Later that month, Robert moved to Chicago with his mother and younger brother, Tad. Robert finished law school, got married, and had a child of his own. Then Tad got sick and died at the age of 18. Robert watched his mother sink into a grief so deep she could barely function. Fearing she might take her own life if left alone, Robert decided his mother had to be committed to a mental institution. But Mary didn't want to go. Robert needed a court to declare her legally insane. So Mary was dragged into court, and the whole nightmare played out in the newspapers, which painted Robert as a cold-blooded villain for testifying against his heartbroken mother. "Oh, Robert," Mary cried, "to think that my son would have ever done this." The jury ruled that Mary was mentally ill, and the judge sent her to an asylum. She got out 4 months later and moved to France. By the fall of 1876, Robert Lincoln had 3 young children and a successful law practice in Chicago. Aside from the fact that his mother refused to speak to him, his life was finally going well. Then Patrick Terrell showed up at his office. Terrell told Robert what he learned from Louis Schwiegel's. Robert was horrified and urged Terrell to protect his father's grave at all costs. Terrell promised to do so, assuring him that night guards had already been assigned to patrol the monument grounds. The next step, Terrell said, was to get rid of the guards. When Robert objected, Terrell explained his thinking. The gang at the hub seemed determined to steal Lincoln's body. Night guards could postpone the attempt, but probably not forever. The only way to end the danger once and for all would be to lure the criminals into the monument and catch them in the act. Robert didn't like this at all, but he trusted Terrell and gave his permission. Word was sent to power in Springfield. The night guards were sent home. Terrell was taking charge of the case, though technically he wasn't supposed to. As a Secret Service operative, his job was to disrupt the distribution of counterfeit money. Nobody told him to chase body snatchers. In his update to Chief Brooks that night, Terrell asked for guidance. "Chief, I do not know your views of what my actions should be in a matter not exactly a counterfeiting case, yet they are well represented in this matter. But, sir, I consider it of national importance should such an attempt be made, and there should be a national hanging bee for those who make the attempt. I shall await your instructions and be governed thereby." Brooks got the telegram, read it, and set it aside. He thought Terrell was overreacting to wild rumors that probably amounted to nothing. Terrell tried to focus on other cases while awaiting word from Washington. Schwiegel's, meanwhile, returned to the hub for a series of backroom meetings with Hughes and Mullen. "Everything was gone over carefully," Schwiegel's later said of his strategy sessions at the hub, "and the conclusion reached that there were no chances of detection at all. There were no guards at the monument, and all there was to do was to go there, shoulder the casket, and carry it off." During one of these meetings, Herbert Nelson showed up to brief the team on the Lincoln Monument layout to help the team. He'd agreed to go to Springfield and take a look, acting like just another tourist. "It's a terribly solid-looking pile," Nelson said of the monument. "But there were really only 2 serious obstacles: the steel door of the tomb chamber and the heavy marble sarcophagus enclosing Lincoln's casket." "Hughes and Mullen are very good burglars," Schwiegel's later explained, "although not capable of any work beyond an ordinary housebreaker. They were going to have to go through metal and stone. This would require special tools, maybe even explosives to blast open the marble box." "You want a man of talent," Schwiegel's told the gang, "someone who specialized in that sort of work." "What they needed," said Schwiegel's, "was a quality cracksman." The others agreed. Schwiegel's was ready with his suggestion. none other than Billy Brown. Swiggles was used to making it up as he went along. No one told him to encourage the team to bring in a fourth man, but he sensed that they were going in that direction, and he decided he'd feel safer if the fourth man was someone he knew. Billy Brown was the man he'd supposedly teamed up with to rob the Wisconsin tannery. Actually, no such robbery had occurred. The man Swiggles called Billy Brown was really a law-abiding bricklayer and friend named Bill Neely. "He is straight, and I knew he could be trusted," Swiggles later said of his choice. What made Brown perfect was his fluency in rough street language. "He can talk crooked," explained Swiggles. He had driven a hack and learned all the slang. Swiggles told Brown he was working for the Secret Service and assured his friend that he too could make a bit of money as a roper. He persuaded Brown to agree to play a cracksman, then talked Terrell into putting Brown on the Secret Service payroll. Terrell didn't mind the idea of having another man inside the gang. Next step, sell Brown to Hughes and Mullen. "I took Hughes down to my house," Swiggles remembered, "and gave him an introduction to Brown. And Hughes took him up to the hub for the purpose of showing him up to Mullen. And they became satisfied that he was all right. He knew just what to do, as I had given him instructions." Convinced Brown was a skilled crook, the Coney men started asking his advice about getting into Lincoln's marble sarcophagus. "A hole could be drilled in it," Brown told him, "and powder put in it and fused, and the whole thing blown to pieces." Mullen and Hughes were satisfied. Brown helped the gang gather the necessary tools, saws, files, drills, gunpowder, and about 6 feet of fuse. Everyone was starting to feel very confident.